thank you very much for the introduction. So yes, hello everybody. I'm back again this year, as I always am at DjangoCon. I have this time, though, want to talk to you a bit more about, not about migrations, but about databases in general. As a sort of little introduction to myself first, I'm Andrew Godwin. As mentioned, I wrote South Migrations. I also wrote Django Migrations. I am a senior software engineer at Eventbrite. We have a booth just down the hall that you come and visit. Very lovely people over there. And I have a small hatred of MySQL, which is not, it's somewhat relevant here, but this is actually a little less bashing on MySQL than I used to. So if you're looking for that, look out for it. But what I want to address here really is a common thing I found, especially when I was a younger, more junior developer in the industry, is this idea of people just saying, just do this. Like we do things this way. And often there's no explanation why. People are like, well, you should just do this pattern. Especially like at university, this is often quite common. Like for a place of learning, it's much more dictatorial, like, oh, okay, we just design things like this, we normalize like this. And sometimes you don't quite get the backstory. So what I'm gonna try and do here today is show you why by counterexample. I'm going to take 8 or 9 different bad ideas and just run through with them until we get to a point where it actually turns out what the problem with them is, rather than just saying they're bad. And this is all part of what I call learning from failure. So if you saw my talk at PyCon this year, that was about, it was called What Can Programmers Learn from Pilots? And a big point of that talk is failure is an expected thing. And in particular, one of the things with both aviation and in some way with this is that every rule, every reason, there's usually something has happened to cause that rule. So in aviation, every law, an accident has usually happened to bring that law into effect. Like every time a crash or incident happens, we look at the results and institute a new law, and that goes into the books to stop happening again. And in software development, that is not quite as coherent. People have their own little specialties, but a lot of the accepted knowledge is there for a good reason, because people decades and decades before us have been through the same stuff. They've been through the same wheels. They've reinvented it. So let's come to the first example here, which is a site called Spacelog. Now, Spacelog is a way of digitizing the audio, well, so the written transcriptions of the audio between the Apollo and Mercury missions from NASA in the 70s and 60s and 80s into a sort of website format. Now, the only format these were in beforehand was a scanned, angled, badly typewritten PDF. So like, you know, they typewrote it in the 80s, stuck it into a folder somewhere in NASA, then about 20 years later, someone comes along, scans them, don't scan great, they're at an angle, they're hard to read, you can't search through them, the OCR doesn't work. So we took all that data, we cleared it up, we put it into a nice website. Now there are two key factors with Spacelog that are relevant. The first one, so yeah, kind of an excuse for myself, is that Spacelog was written in a week here. This is Fort Clonk on the Isle of Alderney in the UK. Now, Fort Clonk is a little unique. It is a Napoleonic era sea fort. This causeway here floods at high tide, isolating it from the entirety of the island. And the island's very small. The island you can walk end to end in about 20 minutes. And even then, like the whole thing isolates off at high tide. It's a wonderful place. It was occupied by the Nazis in World War II as well. But the key thing is, it's part of a thing called DevFort. And DevFort is a thing where you go somewhere for a week, and it's a very intense week of writing a single thing and launching at the end of the week, which is my excuse for the very bad architecture I'm about to show you. So the nice thing about Spacelog is that it's all very old data. This isn't going to change. Like, you know, Apollo 11 isn't still going on. And so we can be pretty sure that all this data is pretty much read-only forever, because once a mission has happened, the transcripts don't change, there's no user features. I highly recommend you make a site with no user features, it's great, because there's no logins, there's no moderation, there's no spam, it just sits there and presents to the world. And naturally, in our sort of somewhat locked away, panicked state, we were like, well, it's read-only. What's really good at read-only stuff? That's it, Redis is great at this. Redis is fantastically fast at read-only operations because you can say, hey, here's a key, give me a value. And so we took all the data, we split it into different chapters, sort of like, oh, here's takeoff, here's entry, here's going around the moon, and we put them into Redis keys. Thought, great, done, ship it. Well, not quite. The problem is, of course, that you need pagination. So like, okay, we'll put every entry into its own key, and so we can load, we can do a multi-get on the keys, still very fast, and we could load 50 of them at a time and do pagination that way. Perfect. And you know, we assumed that the numbers incremented and did nasty things like that. So, okay, cool. So now we have pages that do one multi-get against Redis, still pretty fast. That's fantastic. But then you have the problem that, well, actually, we don't have purely numerical identifiers on these. So we need to give each of them a score, which is its position in the chapter, and then query which keys we want as names by a range by score, and then take that range we get back, and then put that into the multi-get, and then do that. And then also, we need to get the details and the pictures for each speaker, so we're going to then take all the speaker names in that results set and then make them into a list and query that list against another collection in Redis and get the details back from there. And of course, what we've reinvented is select at that point. This is a very roundabout way of doing a select with a join and gets on the table. And of course, it was much slower than a real database was because it can't do the optimizations in memory. And so to this day, Spacelog still runs on this truly special, I think is the word for it, Redis installation that we wrote. And it serves perfectly fine. And there is a varnish cache in front of it because it's not necessarily great at doing things like showing you random pages, but it does tend to work. But you know, this is a place where a normal relational database would have been much better solution. And we were blind to that reasoning until we got to the end. We're like, oh, we obviously should have picked this, you know, 4 days ago, but it's now day 7. We have to leave in like 3 hours. We can't fix it. So a somewhat unique situation there. And this kind of comes on to the second part of this. It's like people like to ignore join. And this is a bigger thing when MongoDB and things were much more popular. And people have this impression that joins are really bad. And if you ask any person who does relational database stuff, like, no, joins are a very important part of the whole thing. But no, joins are bad. They're slow. And to be fair, joins are slow. So let's assume that joins are really slow. Cool. So let's go, well, how do we do stuff? So we have some documents, let's call them. I have some forum posts by myself, and we have a few other authors. And we have some author records. So you know, imagine a forum, you have avatars, you have real names, you have like date joined, that kind of stuff. And what we want to do is we want to show a page in the forum. So what we want to do is we want to take all those forum posts, and for each one of them, we want to find the corresponding author document and put it in place. But of course, to do this, the naive way is to, for every single post, scan the entire author table, find one, put it in, for next post, scan it, and that is very slow. That's n times n operations. Now, you're not stupid developers, I know this, because you're all here, and you're wonderful people. So you would, of course, go, well, Andrew, it's obvious. We can take all of the authors as like a collected set, like I said in the last example, and just do one query with them. I was like, that's great. So what we can do now is we can scan all the posts. We can then build a dictionary that says, okay, well, this post has this author ID, and then do one big author lookup, and then take the bulk result and put all those details back onto the posts. You know, pretty simple. You've reinvented hash join, well done. This is what join does. And join is better at this because it's not having to round trip across the network. And so when I see people reinventing this, I'm like, that's literally what a join is. But of course, some people go, no, but Andrew, you've done it wrong. In documents, you embed things inside other documents. Okay, let's do that. Let's put the authors inside the forum posts. This is kind of the recommended way of doing stuff. So now you can just fetch the post. Everything is great. That's fine until, so let's say a common feature you see on forums is a date, so like, you know, this person was last seen at. So let's put that into our author record. Now, this means whenever I log into your site, you have to scan every single post in the entire database, and on every single post I've ever written, you have to update that record to be the right thing. And so now you've made the sign-in process potentially 30 seconds to a minute long if I've been around the forum a lot. And this is why normalization exists, right? So, and it's one of those things that, like, if you've been down this rabbit hole, you will have come across this particular problem, like I have in the past, and gone, ah, that's why we do it that way. But it's a very important observation of, like, you might think like, oh, people change their usernames like once in a blue moon, it can't be that bad. But there's a lot of other things on a user that can be very rapid fire change. And you've made every single change on that document, on that table, essentially, very, very slow. Another one that is definitely somewhat in my own fault. So when we were at I used to work at Lanyard before we were acquired by Eventbrite. And one of the things we had at Lanyard, and we still have at Lanyard, is a very wonderful set of cached Redis values. So in particular, so this is better than the first example. These are things that should be in Redis. So basically, we take our data set, we work out a few key things like, well, you know, these are speaker scores and whatever, and this is like some clustering information. We put it into Redis for later use in the site so we can sort of get it out quickly. But the unfortunate thing is Redis, at least in the past, and MongoDB in the past as well, when this is happening, they had a, you know, they had a saving system, and neither of them are particularly great. So Redis is one in particular. Redis, it's an in-memory data store, generally. If you want to persist, it would write a brand new save file out. So write it to disk. When it finished writing it, okay, I finished writing it, looks good. Then it would delete the old save file and move the new one into place. Fantastic. The problem is when you run out of disk space, or rather when you have less than twice the disk space for this file, because you try and write the new file, but you've run out of space to write a whole new version of the file, and Redis just doesn't write it. And in the past, when this was happening, it used to not write it, but it kept going. It kept accepting requests. It kept serving things from memory. And so all this data was just going into memory and not being persisted, and you had no idea. Like, we didn't have monitoring at the time for this. We do now. And so, of course, come one day, that server reboots. We're like, oh, we can reboot the server. It's fine. And we lose, like, 6 months of cache data because that data was only in memory. It was never persisted. Thankfully, it was all rebuildable in a couple of hours from our main data store, but if something more valuable was in there, it would have gone away. And this happened to me again on a personal project like a year later, and I should have learned my lesson, but I clearly didn't. Another thing I learned in the hallway this morning was that MongoDB used to do this as well. MongoDB used to, if it ran out of space, just corrupt its own save files. It wouldn't even try and keep it. So, you know, I hope that's now being fixed as well, but there's a lot of things with running out of disk space. Like, give your database servers a lot of room because you do not want them stopping to serve requests or just corrupting themselves or even worse, silent failure, which is keeping on going and you think it's fine, but it's just eating all your data essentially. So be aware of that. And, you know, a small example of how it could be bad, so Eventbrite pays that money to organizers. Now our system is much more robust than this. This is not how we do it. I want to point that out. But if we were like young and naive, we could do it like this. We could do a query to find our unpaid organizers. We could write a row to say, okay, this one's being processed. Because obviously, if it's a cron job, we don't want two of them to run at once and both pay the same person. So we lock the row and mark it as processing. And then we call our bank as an API and say, hey, can you send account number so-and-so this many dollars? And then when that call comes back and says success, we mark them as paid. But of course, what happens if your database is taking writes but not saving them? Well, you never mark as processing, and you never mark as paid. And so your cron job continuously finds all the clients who were ever not paid and continuously pays them money, which, as you can imagine, is not great. But this is why we have proper locks in place at Eventbrite and systems and things like that. But like, if you were doing it naively, be very careful around money. So another thing is, so we come to the other end of the scale now. So previously, we've been people who were like, well, this normalization database stuff, it's a bit much. And now we come to the person who goes, I really love normalization. I love tables. I love them so much. We're going to make a table for everything. This was me 3 years ago. So at Lanyard, Lanyard had, when I joined, it was just Twitter authentication. And we were like, OK, we're going to add emails and passwords, we're going to add LinkedIn, we're going to add Facebook, we're going to add all of the socials, and just have like a, you can sign in with just, you know, any number of things. And I went, that's great. Now, these different backends, the different things, so like for emails, have a table with email and that kind of stuff in it. For Facebook, have the Facebook tokens, for LinkedIn, and like each of their own sort of identifiers. And so we made a table for every single one. Sounds fine. Now, the initial problem with this is, when you try and show somebody their user profile page with all their things set, you have to go and query every single table and go, okay, well, you have, and then for every, like, you have zero LinkedIn accounts, you have three GitHub accounts, you have two Facebook accounts and Twitter accounts, that's not too bad. That's like 6 or 7 queries on a given single page. Login is fine, because login, you know the methods, you just hit the one table. But the problem comes when this page, so this is a speaker or directory page on Lanyard. And if you notice, there are some icons below the people. These icons show that all the accounts they have assigned to Lanyard. In particular, you know, they have at least one Twitter account, at least one LinkedIn account. That means for every row here, we're doing a number of select queries on the number of, like 7 select queries per row. And so this quickly spirals into a, oh my goodness, we have to like do 7 queries per row on this table, and like we can kind of aggregate them-ish, but we can't really, and it quickly makes what could be a simple single select into a much worse prospect. And this, in particular, took us a while to find and fix and clear up. And the key thing here is the database isn't magic. It can't just, if you give it more tables, you're kind of promising your database, you're gonna use them sensibly. You're saying like, you know, I am a competent developer, I understand that tables cost space, they cost time, they're meant for querying things that are separate. And so the correct solution to this is to have a single table with a type column in it, and it's like, oh, type email, type LinkedIn, type Facebook. And then like an identifier column where you like you put the one key thing you look them up by, and then it's a single query. But we didn't know that at the time necessarily. And then following on from this, you have the person who really, really, really loves tables. So I have been developing SQL migrations for too many years. I think it's about 8 now. And I got a lot of emails. Now, a lot of the emails are, Andrew, SQL is terrible, doesn't work. I'm like, it's okay, we'll fix it. And some of the emails are like, Andrew, how do I do crazy thing X? And one of the crazy things X is, I want to make tables at runtime. My reaction to this is this picture. So in particular, I've had people request, so I18N is a very common request here. People are like, hey, I want to make a column per language. So, you know, this is like Django model translation, for example. Like, you have a multi-language site, people have to insert content in multiple languages, so naturally, people's first instinct is to store one per column, or one per table in some cases. Like, oh, this is the English table, this is the French table. Sometimes, I had people come to me and go, well, we're doing kind of a white label hosted solution, but we want to have like a whole set of tables per customer, at which point my reaction is, how many customers are you planning on having exactly? And then some of the even worse ones are writing a CMS, and we want random users in the organization to be able to just add columns by clicking buttons in the back-end CMS. So it's right, I was like just sitting there just clutching my head going, why? So let's take one of these examples, which is the language one. So say you want a column per language, and say you become a site like Facebook that has a global reach. There are approximately 300 to 400 language variants. There's, you know, obviously, like usually one per country, but it's often regional variants. So, for example, there's British English and American English, and they're very different. Like, you spell color differently. In British English, you say bin. In American English, you say trash, and a lot of other words that you want to make sure are translated properly. And so you've not got just language changes, you've got locale changes. And imagine you have a couple of those columns per table. You're looking at a table with over 1,000, possibly 2,000 columns. That's not sensible. Like, your database isn't going to be happy about that. In particular, if you're just trying to select from that table and don't do like column restriction, it's going to try and send you back every single column every time. And that's going to really, really hurt your network connection and slow you down a lot. So don't do that. If you do want to this model, then be very wary of this. But make sure you use dot values and just pick out the columns you actually want rather than requesting everything. But even then, I would really like if you didn't do this, because even if you are adding columns, if you have the wrong database, MySQL, or if you have a default value in a column, adding a column is very expensive. It has to rewrite the storage for every row. Some tables at Eventbrite can take days to add columns to sometimes because we just have so much data in those tables, and we use MySQL, much to my dismay. And so you've got to consider that, like, sure, you can add a column, but if that's an interactive thing from like, if you have like a web page where you click a button and it adds a column, be prepared for that web page to take like potentially hours to return. Of course it won't, because it would cut off with a time limit. But you've got to consider that like adding columns isn't necessarily cheap and fast. And it can, there can be table locks in place, there can all this kind of stuff. And Postgres, as usual, does a lot better at this kind of stuff, and we'll let you get away with it now and again, but it's still tricky. So I kind of recommend that what you do is you either store your translated stuff as like JSON blobs, if you can retrieve from within a JSON blob, like by language. So for example, in Postgres, you can select just certain keys from a blob in JSON. HStore is similar in Postgres, where you could say, okay, this field is like, title is just a HStore of, ENGB is this, ENUS is this, FRFR is this. And you can say, just select the language from that thing. Or the sort of generic ways to have a entity attribute value style table, which is what EAV stands for here, which is a table that's just like, okay, this is column, this is language, this is value. And joining against those things is something that databases can do pretty well. And it will save you a lot of headache in trying to look at the schema and not having it scroll off the side of a screen and like 3 miles down the street. Another fun one, this didn't happen to me, thankfully, is the cold boot. So this is a fun one because it gets really good engineers. So you've written a site, the site has a very good cache hit rate, like you're 75, 80, 90% of the page on the site are hitting the cache, and you're feeling pretty smug. And even better, you've got, like, you know, you've bought down your app server, so they're running at sort of like 70% capacity. Like, you know, you're not wasting money, you've got a good cache hit rate, you're doing fantastically well. Like, great engineering, good job. However, I'm evil. I'm gonna come in and make those cache servers go away. They could have a failure, they could just stop working, but let's say the data in them is lost permanently. So in the case I'm talking about, a power failure hit the servers and they're running memcache, so they lost all the data. Now, you have this problem where you are running at 70% capacity with a 90% cache hit rate. That means that without the cache, you've got 10 times the traffic coming to those backend servers. What's gonna happen is your normal rate is gonna plummet when the cache goes, and when the connection drops, and then as soon as people can get back in, they're gonna just overwhelm your servers with 10 times the normal traffic, and you're gonna just be drowned. And even worse, as soon as you hit the cap on those servers, things will start backlogging and filling up a backlog, or sort of like the sockets will sit there waiting open, and it becomes this immense firefighting situation that's just really hard to recover from. And it can take hours to repopulate that cache. So one of the things we do at Eventbrite when we put builds out is the builds actually pre-warm a cache before they go fully live, just to prevent a smaller version of this kind of thing happening. But it's a very sort of nasty thing because it can happen to you with a really well-planned, perfectly done system. Like, you have to think, can your system handle, like, either can it scale in a few minutes, if that's something you think you can do on a cloud server, or do you have the spare capacity, or can you turn off features for that recovery period, or one of those things. So it's something to bear in mind. The next thing is something I call the optimist. So the optimist is a very, well, let's say enthusiastic developer. And the optimist goes, okay, I've been through a few companies now, I know what I'm doing, we have some great stuff. And we're in a brand new startup, small company, agency, whatever, and we have to build a new project. And so I'm gonna take all the things I learned previously, and we can use all of them at once. So we can have Postgres, we're gonna shard it because we might scale in the future. We can have Elasticsearch for search. We can have React for stuff that we think is inconsistent, but we can do with storing. We can have Redis as like a sort of cache slash data store workaround. We can have some flat files like logging and big blobs and stuff, and do all of these things at once. And that it seems very attractive. It's a very sort of tempting situation where you're like, oh, well, they're all shiny. Like, as a developer, like, at least I am, I'm just drawn like a moth to a flame to, like, it's a new data store and just like wandering towards it. Like, we can put this into the site and install it, it'd be great. One of the things at Lanyard in particular was that we weren't allowed to add a data store without removing a previous one, and you'll see why in a second. Because, sure, you have these, let's say, 5 or 6 different data stores. So, of course, for all those, you've got redundancy, right? And you've got backups for all of them. Cool, okay, so that's your ops workload already much higher than it was. And then what happens if any one of them dies? Likely, if it's a new project, you haven't really built it so the site can handle them going away. For example, you know, what should happen if Elasticsearch goes down is that your search has stopped working, and just your search. But of course, what happens is Elasticsearch is quite good at a lot of things. It's good at like doing big aggregate pages. So you start being like, oh, we'll build the home page of search as well. And then we'll build all the sort of intermediate pages of search as well, then just have the main pages be the main view. And so suddenly you've made Elasticsearch a key part of the site that if it goes down, you consider a major loss. And similarly with Redis, like say, oh, you know, we use Redis for our sessions. So if that's Redis goes away, it's a crucial part of the site. And what you've done is, unless you're very careful, you've made every single one of those backends into a single point of failure. Because if that thing goes away, some crucial part of the site dies. And even if you don't think it's crucial, like some other person, like if it's their pet project or like it's a very important marketing push or whatever, it might be crucial to them. So you have to consider this thing where, sure, more data stores is generally fine. And in particular, if what your problem is isn't shaped to an existing store very well, so say like, you know, you're trying to put a strong graph database into like Postgres. It can do that. It's not particularly great at it, but it can do it. So if it's a really big part of a site, like, hey, we want to get performance improvements here, we want to have a proper store, that's fine, but it's not free. Every store you add is extra redundancy work, extra backups. You've got to make sure it's working and not running out of disk space, like I said before. You've then got to make sure that like it never goes down. And it's just making your surface area bigger. So like if you're a small project or company, really try and use one or two things. It's a lot easier when it's 3 a.m. and one of them goes down, because that happens like much, much less of the time because there's only two of them. And if it's Redis or Postgres or something, those things are pretty much solid. And so like you're working on a lot less than less reliable stores. MySQL. It's fine. It's actually quite, the one thing it's good at is staying up generally. And then this comes to a different kind of optimism, which I've seen quite a lot, is we all have, and Django kind of encourages this, Django has a primary key field that is an auto-incrementing integer. In particular, it has this sort of wonderful thing that as you sort of add more records, it increments. That's what auto-incrementing means. And so people go, that's great. So we have this number that goes up. That means that the highest value primary key is the most recent one. I mean, that's not true, right? So first of all, if you're running that for precise ordering, well, different pages can go through to the backend different times. So like, you should put timestamps on them, for example. If you're running a cluster, that's definitely not true. And clustering is the problem here, because this works on a single instance, but you quickly realize that auto-increment is a really nasty feature to scale, to the point where Twitter wrote entire software stacks to do this for them, to just make sure their numbers auto-incremented roughly correctly. Because if you think about it, if you've got a cluster of like 20 database storage servers, they have to all agree on what the next number is, and they have to not pick the same number. And so you end up with all these solutions like, well, okay, we'll assign each of the servers in the ring a number modulo 20, and so this one only does like ones, this one does twos, this one does threes, or like we'll have them skip around, and it becomes very difficult to have numbers that even scale roughly correctly. So assuming this is kind of a bad thing. And the other one I've particularly annoyed is that IDs are numbers we can do maths on. No, they are not. They are opaque things you should never treat as numbers. I have this big thing wherever I go, and I've been doing this internally in Eventbrite for a little while, is making IDs as strings, even if they're numbers, making them strings, because they are not numeric. You can't do maths on them, right? That doesn't make any sense. I can't add 3 to an ID to go somewhere. It's not even like a pointer where that might do something useful. It's like, you know, if you try and do pagination by adding numbers to IDs, what are you doing? I've seen occasions like, you know, people want to inflate their IDs to look good. So for example, they might start a brand new site and go, okay, we don't want to have like this customer's page be ID 1 because it looks really bad for our customer. So we'll start at number 3,804. But we'll do it all in the front end, so we'll subtract that number whenever a request comes in, we'll add it when it goes out. You see where that ends up, right? If you want IDs that don't give away how many rows you have, use UUIDs. Like, they're built into databases. They're basically guaranteed not to collide. Like, we have native support for them in Django 1.8. It's great. You know, don't sit there and be that person who does this. But of course, we come on to my favorite part of the presentation. So I was at PyCon Ukraine many years ago, 3 or 4 years ago. I saw a wonderful talk. And the crux of the talk was, well, we have this database. It's Postgres. And Postgres can run Python. Like, why are we wasting network overhead querying to and from the database, doing views, when we can just run it right there and save the overhead? And so Postgres has functions. Now, I have some problems with functions and sort of standardized queries. A lot of enterprise software in particular will write all of their complex operations as basically functions that you can run. So, like, so to, you know, to add a page, you just call, like, select add page, and then brackets, stuff. And the idea is it's meant to encode all the complex logic into the database, so it happens there. The problem is that you can't version control that code, right? That code isn't in version control, it's in the database somewhere. You need to put it in a migration system to have it version controlled, and even then have it overwrite properly, and it becomes a whole mess. But that's even not what this is about. This is about Python functions and people who are slightly over. And I will say, I've never seen this in production, but it's such a great thing I had to show you anyway. So they're Python functions. You can import stuff in them. In particular, you can do templating these Python functions. And so if you were, say, particularly enthusiastic, you could go, well, we can render the template straight in the database. Why would we, you know, we could just use Ginger in a Python function. And at this point, you're thinking, well, Andrew, that's a silly idea. No one would ever do that. Well, here is the code that does this. If you want to go to it, if you want to have internet right now, I'm going to show it to you right now on the screen. So that SQL file I just showed you, bit.ly/why-not-pg, contains a schema and a function that renders HTML directly from the database. In particular, you do select render brackets template name page name, and it outputs here we are, this. You get this out. You just get a column back, which is the rendered HTML of the page. And even better, because Postgres has regular expressions, you could put the URL routing into a select query that uses the regular expression from the page. It's awful. The code is not to be used in production. This is a very express thing from me. Here's the example of that text. And, like, you know, it's pretty simple. We import Ginger. PL Python will just import things from your standard system Python path. We can just execute a select query against another table in PL Python. It's pretty great. It comes back as a dictionary of, like, column names to values. We then just select the template string from another table and then just pass that to Ginger. Like, Ginger will take the dictionary, it takes the template name, and just renders HTML. It doesn't know it's doing it in a database. And you could do more. You could do views in here. You could do, like, custom saving stuff. You could do all manner of things. Don't, but you could. that's my thing. And, like, the presentation ended up with this. I was just like, why is this a thing? And it didn't come with quite as strong as warning as this one does. So it's possible. Don't do this. Do it in Django. Django is written by mostly sensible people, myself excluded. But the crux of the thing is there's a reason behind every rule, right? Like, there's a reason why people generally stray away from stored procedures and functions. There's a reason why we don't generally make a table per individual type. And all of these have exceptions, right? Like, you shouldn't, nothing in programming is a hard and fast rule. In particular, a lot of people just won't believe things, or, you know, technology changes and gets faster and we get better CPUs. So you should, every piece of information or recommendation you get, you should ask why. Like, if somebody tells you don't do this, just ask, be like a small child, go, why? And just, like, because, like, often there's reasoning there, and it's very sensible reasoning. Like, if you come into a company that's been around for, like, many years, they'll have certain internal processes and design patterns, and often there's a good reason why things are written like they are. But as a new engineer, your instinct is to go and just go, this is all terrible, let's rewrite it. And you're going to that sort of pothole of, well, actually, there's all these hidden requirements that you never realize, and then it'll take you, like, a year to rewrite it, and then you end up with the same complex code as before. So just take a moment to ask why, or just, if it's a simple thing, just as I've done here, take the thing you think is good and just try it, see what happens, see what the eventual result is. Sometimes that's not possible because it, like, requires a scale to break, but you can do, like, thought experiments and just, like, work through it in your head. But just don't write them off without context. Don't go, psh, they don't know what they're doing. Don't, like, you know, don't dismiss 40 years of database research. Don't dismiss people who know what they're doing, like, you know. There are many, many engineers at Eventbrite who are much better than I am, who have been around the industry and programming for a lot longer, and like they're full of really interesting and useful information from very esoteric parts of programming that, you know, there's very good reasoning behind everything that they say, and sometimes there's not enough time to say why the thing is like that is, but sometimes there is. So to just ask why, basically. Thank you. So I believe we have some time for questions. So the question is basically like going into company and not really think it's fine, but like how do we get the knowledge I'm talking about here in the first place? How do we get that embedded knowledge of don't make tables for every translation and stuff? It's a difficult problem. Like part of it is doing this kind of thing and talking to people and giving explanations. But I think part of it also is like, you know, you can still go into a company and be a positive influence. You can be that person who asks why, and occasionally the why will be, we don't know why, and then they can go and ask why, and you'll discover that the thing is a terrible idea. So if you just sort of, if you leave something better than when you joined, like it's a cleaning up rule, right? So you should ask why, and you should try and come in, because like there are things that you, as a developer, will know better than other developers, right? Every one of us has our specialty, we gain it slowly over the years, but it does happen. And so there are things that you'll be better at. And so don't be afraid to ask why and then provide like, well, I do it like this way because of this. I think like slowly but surely you can improve institutional knowledge that way to make things better. Okay, so the question is, what's my feeling on columns like JSON and HDOR and like schemaless data types in columns in relational databases? I really like them. I'm a big proponent of mixing schemas. So in particular, one of my big things I like to do on new projects and things where I can is, in any given table, there are certain columns that are core, they're important, like the ID column, the name column, title column, created date. And there are columns that aren't as important. There are things that could be stored in JSON. So what I quite like doing is, if you're going to query on the column, make it a full column. If it's just sort of a user configurable thing, so like a CMS is a great example of this, right? You can have a CMS where every CMS page has a URL slug, it has a created date, it has an author, it has all this stuff, but they might have like a whole bunch of configurable things. Put those in the JSON blob and put the core fields as table rows. And then you've got this good combination of, if you add all the, like, you know, the complex changing lot of the time stuff is in a nice blob, doesn't need schema updates, and the core fields that you're querying and doing, like ordering against, are all in proper table rows. And so I think that's a great combination. And even without a proper JSON type, you can do it like in MySQL, as long as you're not querying into it, you can still store things as JSON blobs. You just can't necessarily query into them as efficiently as you otherwise could, but it's still a perfectly valid schema design, I think. Cool, thank you very much.